Hello. Thank you for coming to my session. This will be Adoptable Goats Near Me, what I Googled the year I became a developer. Before we get really into it, let me actually start the presentation. My name is Qymana Botts. I work at a place called Nerdery in Chicago. Nerdery is a digital business consultancy working at the leading edge of strategy, design, and technology to help clients evolve and thrive. Our motto and our mission is to relentlessly invent a world that works better for all. It's a really great place to work, and they sent me here, so they're pretty great. So back to the whole I'm Qymana thing. How many of you have Googled yourselves? Great, so we have basically everyone in the room. Awesome. I Googled myself frequently. And back in 2016, where our story begins, this is more or less what you would find if you Googled Qymana. Before I started working for companies that had SEO or even knew what search engine optimization was, if you Googled me, you would find things like an IMDb page where I was a production assistant for my friend's short film, or a Bandcamp page that has an album that I wrote to fund my first trip as a professional overseas. And that trip eventually led to where I found myself in April of 2016, which was signing a contract, a two-year contract, to help develop an English music curriculum for an international school in Beijing. So you might be wondering, how did this person with an IMDb page and a Bandcamp and also a face cream named after them, and that's actually named after me, how did that person end up being in front of me here at DrupalCon Amsterdam, which is a Drupal conference, and not either of those things? Well, that is what I'm here to talk to you about today. So, children's books about terminal illness. These are all things that I Googled the year I became a developer. Well, friends, in May of 2016, a month after I had signed my contract to go teach in Beijing, my mother informed me that she had stage 4 ovarian cancer. And after a hard-fought battle, she passed away in December of that year, at which point I took custody of my then 9-year-old sister. So you might be wondering, why would you lure me here at 10:45 in the morning to just make me sad immediately? You promised me goats, and now you're just talking about terminal illness. What's wrong with you? You're mean. Couple of reasons. First, chronologically, this is what happened. Second, if you start from children's books about terminal illness, you can really only go up from there. So hoping things get better from there. But really, this is to kind of preempt the thesis of this whole talk, which is that there is something to learn from every situation, with an asterisk. Learning occurs constantly, and it's not, what I'm saying is not to distill your experiences into a nice little silver lining kind of, you know what, sad thing happened, but the good news is that now I can, it's not that, it's not, oh, other side of the rainbow is shiny and stay positive. It's not to do that. Not necessarily to distill all of your experiences into these quippy little swirly font over sunrise kind of situations. It's not to do that. What I'm saying is that you can get information from all of your experiences. When I look at learning, I think of, what do I know now that I didn't know before? And so what the situation with my mom and my sister taught me is that, like, I now know my thresholds for grief, right? I know how to handle certain kinds of situations. I know more about myself as a person and how I handle stress. I know more about how to communicate with people and things like that. And so that's kind of what I'm pushing here, is to just assess kind of where you were and where you are and figure out what knowledge has been gained in that timeline. So yeah, when I talk about learning throughout this, I will basically be talking about the acquisition of knowledge or skills through experience, study, or by being taught. So just knowledge, not necessarily like Hallmark card situations. So over the months following my mom's passing, I learned a lot. Sometimes I learned through experience. Sometimes I had to Google it. Like, is it okay to let a child eat oatmeal for dinner? But then after things got kind of settled down, I started looking into going back to work. So at the time I was working at a junior college, and I was teaching at a like a pre-university kind of situation, and I needed something long term. But what I knew is that I needed something where I didn't want to be responsible for like the well-being of other children. I knew that like I was, my hands were full enough with my sister, and I didn't want to be responsible for that kind of thing. And I'd always loved coding and programming, like, as a hobby. I had made a couple of small games here and there. And so I started to think about what other things I could do, because teaching in the United States, teachers are not treated well, and that's really unfortunate, and as unfortunate as that is, I couldn't, like, as noble as a profession is, I didn't want to subject myself to that mistreatment. There was already too much kind of stuff going on in my life. So I decided to look into coding boot camps, and I found one, which is now defunct, called Dev Boot Camp. And there, it was an 18-week intensive course that taught coding and like the basics of programming and things like that. And basically, like, you sit in a room and you code for several weeks, and then at the end of it, you hopefully have some basic knowledge so that you can go and get a job. So this is what I kind of like learned there, is that like failure provides context and discomfort provides a catalyst. You don't need to be perfect at everything all the time, 100% the first time you do it. There is intense value in failing and being like uncomfortable. Now, when I say discomfort and when I'm talking about uncomfortable, I don't mean like safety. I mean, so on the slides is a diagram where you have on the y-axis you have motivation and accountability. On the x-axis you have psychological safety. Now, when I say discomfort, I don't mean like I don't feel safe in this situation. I don't mean that like I'm stressed out or things like that. Where learning takes place is at the kind of sweet spot where you feel psychologically safe. But when you feel motivated and you're held accountable for your learning, that is what I mean by discomfort. So like, there are stakes to your learning, but you feel safe. So if you, for example, don't feel like psychologically safe, but you're also not motivated, you might be apathetic to what you're trying to learn. If you are maybe not psychologically safe, but have like serious motivation or like accountability, like there's a lot of pressure on you to learn the thing or like to succeed, you might be in the anxiety zone, right? Where you're anxious all the time and it's maybe not the most healthy place to be. If you are not super motivated, but also psychologically safe, you're in your comfort zone. It's a nice, comfortable place to be, but that's not where that important friction happens. So ideally, you will be in a position where you're psychologically safe, but also like highly motivated and held accountable for your learning and the things that you're trying to produce. So failure, going back to failure, it deepens our knowledge of what we're trying to work with. When you fail, your expertise isn't brittle. You need to know how to handle things when they break, because things break more often than not, right? If I only write like perfect clean code and never encounter an error message, when I'm working in a production environment and I get an error message, like I will never have encountered that. But if I break a bunch of stuff all the time while I'm learning, and I get to see all of these cool error messages and have to figure out how to solve them, then the depth of my knowledge is like that much more robust. As I continued in this program, I ended up doing lots of Ruby projects, lots of like HTML, JavaScript, but then my final project was an Angular, and I am not like a front-end kind of person. I don't, like, Angular is not my jam. I'm not a huge Angular person. So there's a lot of like intense stuff that had to happen. When trying to acquire more knowledge or like a new skill or learn something new, context is important. That is both providing context like about the actual subject matter, but also like where you are doing your learning. Your retention will improve if you are learning in different environments. If, for example, one day you're doing the same, like you're doing some exercises and you're like in your office, and then maybe the next day you go work at a coffee shop, you're kind of like reinforcing the knowledge by generalizing it in your brain so that you can access that stuff later. Also, testing yourself kind of goes back to the failure thing, where like the quickest way to get that feedback, that like failure feedback, is to like get a thing wrong. You're more likely to remember something if you do it incorrectly. So maybe don't rely on like templates, or don't run to the docs immediately when you're like redoing a thing, right? Like maybe you try to recall it from memory so that you're understanding, okay, well, these are the components that need to be in this thing. And that's not to say like don't ever use those things. It's just when you're learning them, it's more helpful to like have to do the thing before relying on the tools that make quality of life a little bit easier. Also, teach someone. I had the luxury of having a 9-year-old person that asked me what I did all day at the dinner table, and I would have to explain to this 9-year-old person code things. And I will tell you right now, if you can explain what you're doing to a child, you have a very good understanding of what you're doing. If you can, because you have to like not use any jargon, you can't use any technical things. Like being able to explain things in its in their simplest terms means it's a great way to like to figure out like how deeply you understand the fundamentals of what you're working with. So if you don't have a child of your own, perhaps borrow a nephew or a niece and be like, hey, guess what I learned about JSON API today? Just something like that, I don't know. But teaching someone else will help you. I need a burrito. So, as we kind of near the end of our story, it was the final week of my coding bootcamp, and I was very hungry because I was coding for like 18 hour days, and it was just like really awful, and I'm like, I need a burrito. Angular is treating me terribly. So I went and got a burrito, and there I met a person, and he heard me being like real enthusiastic and being like, oh, I'm so excited about my final project and all this stuff. And he was like, hey, do you do code things? And I'm like, I do code things. I love it, and it's the best thing ever. And he's like, cool, do you want a job? And I'm like, yes, I would love a job. And that's basically how I got my first job. Just being really enthusiastic about coding, like as enthusiastic about coding as I was about mediocre burritos. So just keep that in mind if you're ever in a job search. But enthusiasm begets enthusiasm. Bothering people is real fun, and it can be productive. Did you know that, like, there are people that make things, and people that make things like the things that they make? And if you want to learn about a thing, the person that made the thing is probably, like, real anxious to, like, talk to a person about this cool thing that they made. So when you want to bother someone, you're not really bothering them. It's strategic bothering. You find someone that, like, is really enthusiastic about talking about the things that you want to listen to about. So that's kind of how I got a lot of my, like, initial knowledge, is that I was just like, oh my gosh, Migrate API is real cool. How do I do this thing? And then I just found people that, like, were really into Migrate API. And then I'm like, I learned a bunch about Migrate. And I'm like, well, you know what? How about just object-oriented programming in general? And then, like, people that are just, like, real cool. Maybe no one wants to listen to them talk about, like, source plugins for 2 hours. Maybe that's not what they want to do. But I would love to talk to someone about source plugins for 2 hours. So that's, like, a good match. So you find someone who is enthusiastic about talking about the things that you want to learn about. And it usually like ends up being really, really good, especially in a community like Drupal. Also, mentoring works both ways. At the end of my bootcamp, I immediately signed up to be a mentor at a different bootcamp. Because the way I look at it is that, like, yeah, I didn't know a whole lot about coding and programming and things like that, but also, I knew more than I did when I first started. And if I knew more than I did when I first started, there are people that are where I was when I first started. You can help at any point in your journey, whatever you're learning. Like, you can help someone, because there's always going to be someone that doesn't know as much as you. And for that matter, like, someone learning a thing, you are just so close to having learned the thing, so that you might know, like, you have it fresh in your heads. An instructor might not have, like, oh, well, last Tuesday I had to solve this problem. That an instructor may not have, like, encountered the same problems that, like, someone that has, like, freshly learned the thing has, like, encountered very recently. So, like, wherever you are in your learning journey, you can help. And if you don't have, like, the answers, research it together, and it's great. Like, you can help at whatever point, and just being a person that, like, has gone through that experience and that kind of stuff is, like, really important. So whatever stage you're at, mentoring is great, and people always want mentors, and it's very beneficial both for you and for the person that you're mentoring. It also holds you accountable to, like, know what you're talking about, because you don't want to tell someone the wrong information. And then just showing up. Part of the reason why I'm here today is because I just put my face in people's area, and then I'm like this, and then people are like, you're there, I've seen that face before, let's do a thing. And I'm like, yeah, sure, I'll put my face in the thing, and it's cool. Like, just being where you are, and just showing up and saying yes and being open to opportunities is, like, super valuable, because you get to meet so many cool people that are doing such cool stuff, and also, like, you get to help out, and then you get to learn more stuff. And it's just this ever-growing cycle. And I came across this Angela Davis quote very recently, that kind of boils down to, like, as you rise, you should lift people up. So, like, as you continue to learn, and as you kind of, like, gain this, like, mountain of knowledge, you can also just lift people up and bring people with you. And, like, that way we can make, like, a much stronger community. So how do you want to talk? That's the end of my talk. But before I go, contribution opportunities. There's mentored contribution, first-time contributors workshop, and general contribution. You can find it in your programs or in the app. And also, I would love feedback. So if you go to the session on the DrupalCon Amsterdam website, you can leave me feedback there. And then also leave feedback for DrupalCon Amsterdam. And that's my talk. The end.
Thank you.